He is so rude. He is a gamer with a bad attitude. Come on, guys. He plays the game.
His name is Alexander 4488.
They insult the baby. They are so lame. Now listen up. Game Dude is his name. Spends most of his
time. This is going on your channel, BTW.
Some from the present, some from the past.
Alexander Jared Hams Batter was a film student from Canada who established an online presence in the YouTube gaming community between 2007 and 2015. Operating under the username Alexander4488 and better known under his alias, The Game Dude, a lot of information about this individual is sparsely documented on the internet. It's even harder to get a definitive timeline of the events as they occurred. I would like to do my part in documenting Alex's evolution on YouTube, to demonstrate how he went from being a nerdy young man making game reviews in his parents' den to getting into massive amounts of legal trouble which changed his life forever. The YouTube gaming community is an ever-expanding subculture. Nowadays, you can find a whole host of popular content analyzing video games with different styles and approaches. Back in the pioneering days of the website, when having millions of subscribers wasn't really a thing and high-quality video production was much more of a novelty, trends amongst the type of content being produced was much more long-lasting than it is today. One such trend was that of angry reviewing, popularized in 2006 by James Rolfe. His series, The Angry Nintendo Nerd, rebranded later to Angry Video Game Nerd, featured the titular character reviewing, or more accurately, ranting about retro Nintendo games in a comedically over-exaggerated fashion.
Cowabunga. Cow a fucking piece of dog shit. This game is diarrhea coming out of my dick. This game is as appealing as a fucking ooze-infested, dirty fucking sewer rat shit. I've had more fun playing with dog turds. Shredders my ass and splinters my balls. This game is an inside-out asshole regurgitating putrid anal fecal matter. I'd rather fucking yank all the hairs out of my scrotum. I'd rather drink diarrhea vomited out of a buffalo's anus. It sucking fucks, it fucking sucks, it fucking blows, it's a piece of shit. And I don't like it.
The videos garnered large success, and Rolf's channel quickly skyrocketed to being the most watched channel in the gaming community at the time, with the possible exception of Machinima, if that counted. As is the case in any medium, a man achieving a large amount of success and recognition leads to others looking for a way to ride the same wave. A lot of the staples which we see in YouTube gaming content nowadays were at the time non-existent or much less prominent. So many creators gravitated toward the biggest fish in the pond as inspiration, and thus the gaming community became inundated with people doing angry reviews, with many using James as a source of inspiration. One of the more infamous examples at the time was that of Chris Boers, who started producing a show called The Irate Gamer back in 2007. I'd be here all day if I were to get into the Irate Gamer drama, so let me get to the point. People heavily criticized Boers' show for various reasons, with the main point of contention being that the character he created was very similar to, arguably a carbon copy of, the angry video game nerd. In certain cases, such as his Back to the Future and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles reviews, Boers lifted certain lines of dialogue from Rolf's reviews of the same games.
It's some game designer who's laughing their ass off just decided to put a pizza down there. Okay, well, what's the point? I mean, are you going to be suicidal enough to go and try to get that pizza? I mean, who's going to do that? It's impossible. What a joke.
So what the fuck were they thinking when they placed a pizza box way down here? Now, just how the hell am I supposed to get to this in time? If I go for it, I end up dying. So what's the reason for this? What a bunch of Aspergers with a side of fries.
At the time, Chris made almost no reference to James in any of his videos. This led to many people labeling Chris as a plagiarist, and unworthy of the position that YouTube put him in by featuring his videos on their homepage. Despite Irate Gamer being as hated as he was, he was still quite successful in terms of growth and views, further demonstrating how popular James' specific style of content truly was. And people were clearly taking notes because this didn't deter people from continuing to ape this review format. And one of those people taking notes was a certain gamer with a bad attitude.
He is the game dude. He
Alexander Batra, operating under the username Alexander4488, started posting videos on his channel sometime in 2008. It's hard to really say for sure when his first upload was, but according to this forum post on digitalpress.com, it was sometime around July of that year. Hello, I am the Game Dude. I was the Annoyed Gaming Geek, but because that name is a ripoff of the Angry Video Game Nerd, I changed it to Mega Gamer. But because that name is a ripoff of the Irate Gamer, I changed it to Game Dude. I have been reviewing video games for 2 months. I've never written a script, voice acted, edited a video, and have barely used a camera, so don't complain too much if you don't like the videos. I taught myself everything. One day, I literally just randomly jumped into it. If you don't like my videos, I will accept logical, constructive criticism, but no insults. Besides, there's no excuse for anyone not to be able to do as good or better than me, since I did it from the ground up by myself. All of my videos are inspired of the Angry Video Game Nerd, and he had made a favorite of one of them and wrote back a letter in response saying that he likes my videos. Personally, I don't like them for the same reasons you may not. Here is a link to my YouTube account. Remember that all flaws are obsolete, for I've just started Vancouver Film School today, so all of the videos might as well not exist. I will strive for the best and never give up. Tomorrow will be the first day I will hopefully learn something I didn't have to painstakingly teach myself. Trust me, it was a pain in the ass having to learn it by myself, and it will still and always will be a pain in the ass making high quality game reviews. Yes, my voice is annoying and the acting is shit, but everything will change. Subscribe if you like. My goal is to do high quality reviews like the nerd, but be original. I'm going all out, and I'll intertwine some live action stories in there too, but not be a ripoff, and maybe even have my own theme song. I was thinking of some dude playing the piano while singing or something like that. No, he will not be playing a guitar for obvious reasons. I like all video game reviewers, but the mockeries. Nerd is the king. Long live the nerd. I would like some advice too. Thanks. According to his channel description, he states, inspired by the Angry Video Game Nerd, these videos are tributes. They are not reviews, but satirical, comedic parodies of gamers that yell at games for minor flaws. The entire point of the videos is to nitpick the games to death. I like all games, so don't take these videos seriously. To give you an idea what the Game Dude show was like and how much he liked to pay tribute to the AVGN, I'll play a few clips from selected episodes.
Sonic the Hedgehog is brilliant, and so is Sonic the Hedgehog, but Sonic the Hedgehog is the absolute worst Sonic game ever made. This ignominy of the universe needs to be buried in the darkest region on Pluto. Now, as retarded as three different Sonic games, all with the exact same name is, must this pile of hedgehog shit be one of them? It's a shameful disgrace! Anyway,
Sonic losers! Why? Because Sega hates you. Where do I begin?
This game is a disgrace to the Bandicoot's legacy. Damn this damn floating beluga whale shit engulfs the seaweed down the damn beaver dam. And have more fun making deer shit mud pies. It's the shameful disgrace of mankind. Sonic the Hedgehog meets your new best friend. What are you laughing about, Spyro the Dragon? You're next!
Look at me, I'm Donkey Kong!
During his time on YouTube, Alexander produced nearly 30 episodes of the Game Dude series. Information on the order in which these episodes were released are scattered and often contradictory. To the best of my ability, I've compiled this list of episodes of his show in chronological order, although I can't say for certain if this is 100% accurate. As I mentioned earlier, Chris Bors was getting a lot of hate at the time for copying James Rolfe without any acknowledgement. Alexander decided to circumvent this by doing the opposite. By acknowledging James as a source of inspiration in every episode of the Game Dude show. This included adding a title card at the end of each video saying, inspired by the AVGN, nerd-spired, or some similar variation. Other times he would pay tribute directly by quoting AVGN's lines in his own script. In his Chameleon Twist review, he plays out the AVGN's theme song on a piano in the game. If the irate gamer's videos were viewed by the community as plagiarism, GameDude made sure his videos were viewed as tributes. Did this effort deter people from trolling Alexander?
Hello, AdAVGN here. Sorry, I meant to say GameDude. When I'm not stacking shelves at Walmart, I like to make shitty videos of myself and upload them on YouTube in order to brainwash 12-year-old fanboys into sending naked pictures of themselves over MSN.
The trolling of Alexander4488 is a long and complicated web of information to untangle, especially if you weren't around back in the day to witness it happen. Basically, as GameDude's show received more traction amongst the YouTube community, many people started to take note of what he was doing and responding to it. Many of the responses at the time were highly critical of GameDude's content. A few of the general criticisms levied at his reviews at the time were that Alexander generally had poor delivery, bad writing, inconsistent editing, and was too nitpicky. The most prominent criticism was that Alex was unoriginal and his style was too similar to that of James Rolfe's. It seemed that Alex's attempt to curb the criticism by acknowledging the nerd was futile. And that came with even more criticism, not just regarding the content of GameDude's show, but also toward the way Alex conducted himself online. Let me create a list of a few of the contentions people had with his actions around this time. One thing Alex was known to do in the early days of his channel was self-promotion. Essentially, Alexander would go to comment sections of other people's videos, most notably those of the AVGN and Irate Gamer, and post comments promoting his own channel. He also did this on several forum websites as shown earlier. Here are a couple examples of these comments. You've seen the angry video game nerd. You've seen the Irate Gamer. You've seen the nostalgia critic. Now meet the Game Dude. I am the Game Dude. Watch me now. Wow, have you guys seen the Game Dude? Damn, he's fucking awesome. Watch his hilarious video game reviews. I just watched the Game Dude. His jokes are so funny, ha ha ha. I know, especially the Sonic the Hedgehog review. I couldn't stop laughing. He should have over 1 million subscribers by now. I so agree. Hey, who is the Game Dude, by the way? I am the Game Dude, of course. Click on my channel and watch my videos, which are so funny. Why are they so fucking funny? It doesn't make sense. I've been losing sleep over it. They're that funny. Too funny. You will die of laughter. Watch me now! These comments would almost always get flagged as spam. In the later years of the Alexander4488 channel, he would stop doing this as a result of the criticism he was receiving. But that didn't stop people from criticizing him about other things. One accusation Alex received quite often was that he was a closeted furry. I'm not sure if this stemmed from a specific incident necessarily, but I think many people drew this conclusion from a few different factors. Number 1. The focus of GameDude's show tended to be on games that star big, furry, anthropomorphic animal characters. Games such as Sonic, Blinx, Bubsy, Star Fox, Mickey Mouse, Crash, Banjo, Conker, Gex, Felix the Cat in the Hat, and the list goes on. In fairness to him, I think that's partly because GameDude tended to focus on platformers in his reviews, and platformers generally tend to have characters like this, but of course, that's not going to stop people on the internet from drawing conclusions. Number 2. A lot of the swearing in GameDude's videos tend to have analogies to animals. Kind of like how AVGN combines poop analogies with swear words in his videos, Alex would make references to animals in his rants.
Rocky and Bullwinkle! More like Rocky bullshit! This game is a tiger taking a diarrhea up my ass! This game is a buck full of rotten, disintegrating, regurgitated squirrel moose shit mixed in a blender. I'd rather clean a shitty asshole than a giant panda using my tongue. It sucks so much it fucks so much it blows, it's the abomination of all time, a waste of time, and it's time to put an end to this ignominious travesty!
Oh, come on, that's just bull ass! Fuck damn it! This is just a fuck platypus.
Alexander probably didn't help his case when he uploaded this commercial onto his channel.
Hey, I got PK!
Oh, sweet. Oh man, there's onions in this.
They must have made a mistake.
That can't be right. I mean, Burger King always makes it my way.
Well, maybe somebody messed up this time.
Maybe. This is all a dream.
Oh, please. If this was a dream, you could do more than just put onions in your burger. Turn yourself into a talking animal.
A talking animal? What's the matter with you?
Burger King, have it your way.
Hey, are you gonna wake up soon? You're leaving furballs in the drain.
Sorry.
Stemming from this furry fiasco, a common meme back in the day was that Game Dude liked to have sex with sheep.
that was just a cheap little immature gag I had tucked away in the corner. It meant nothing. I don't know, one of the YouTube users actually randomly said something about screwing sheep, and then as a joke, I was like, yeah, I screwed them. I screwed them when I forced them to read your stupid comments. And then all the type-writing chimpanzees at Ed took it too serious.
Alex denied the furry accusations, although he did state he had no problem with furries. Something he did have a problem with, though, was his penis. Something Game Dude probably didn't plan on sharing with his audience was his plight of being circumcised. Alexander was active on a forum website called foreskinrestoration.net. Here he asked questions regarding his purchase of a TLC Tugger, a device which is designed to restore foreskin for circumcised men. I'm not going to go into specifics. Anyway, Game Dude made the mistake of using his Alexander4488 username on this forum when he was asking his questions. People eventually found the posts when searching his username. In retaliation, Alexander went back and re-edited the posts so that nobody could find out the specifics of what he was talking about. Unfortunately for him, the people in the forum who responded to him quoted his questions in their responses. Since re-editing a post doesn't alter the questions and quoted responses, the quotes remained up on the forum. Let's have a read. I don't have a retainer, but I suppose there's no harm in tugging 24/7. Guess I could just the TLC Tugger without a strap or MRS for less tension here and there. Is it safe to use that MRS remover stuff on the TLC Tugger to remove the sticky goo? When I apply the TLC Tugger, does there need to be like a millimeter of inner skin beneath the outer cone to know that I'm stretching it? Otherwise, I assume the TLC Tugger would only be stretching the shaft skin since all the inner skin would be inside the cone. Would stretching slowly reduce the suture holes? How would a plastic surgeon fix them, and wouldn't that be really expensive? There's only like three together and they're not that big. I started tugging with the strap at half its maximum length, causing way too much tension. After taking off the TLC Tugger, a liquid bubble, two red dots, and a small red line formed. What are they, and where did they come from? The next day, the liquid red bubble and the red line almost fully disappeared, but the two red dots minimized. Should I be concerned? I now have the strap at about 5 inches away from maximum length, and it seems to be the perfect length. It does get slightly bothersome after 4 to 5 hours, though. Starting out, how many inches away from the tugger should I put the safety pin? Apparently, some people have experienced problems tugging at night. Should I avoid tugging at night for now? I'll never forgive my parents for circumcising me. Circumcision is the dumbest thing to get popular, and it should be banned. Speaking of re-editing things, this leads into the final contention people had with Alexander, but undoubtedly the biggest one, the one that made even his genuine fans turn on him. If you try to look up one of Game Dude's reviews on YouTube nowadays, you might notice that there are different versions of almost all of them. That's because Alex was notorious for revising his work. He had a philosophy. Back when YouTube videos were rated on a 5-star system, as opposed to the thumbs up, thumbs down system it uses today, Alex would gauge the value of his videos on the rating that they had. If one of his reviews had a lower rating than what he was aiming for, he would take down the video, make small changes to it, and put it back up. So far, my goal is to have no 3.5-star rated videos. I have one curse that needs to be revised, and that's the awful Mario Kart review. After that, I must have no 4-star rated videos, then no 4.5-star rated videos. They all must have 5 stars, and I will reach that goal for sure. Game Dude said he was doing this for people who hadn't been exposed to his channel yet. Therefore, if a newcomer found his channel for the first time, his review would have a lot less quote-unquote mistakes in it for that person to see. Unfortunately for those already subscribed, it meant seeing the same reviews popping up in their inbox over and over and over again. This got on everyone's nerves very quickly and resulted in his own fans downvoting every video he re-uploaded. Not seeming to care that he was pissing off his fans, this resulted in an endless cycle of the videos being removed and re-uploaded until he had an exodus of subscribers. Even in the later years of the Alexander4488 channel, after he stopped filming new reviews, he would still post revisions on a constant basis. The revisions often didn't improve his reviews. In fact, many complained that the over-editing botched the pacing of the original videos. In a few instances, GameDude would butcher his lines from what they originally were to the point where they no longer made sense. One of the more infamous instances of this was in the opening monologue of his Barbie review.
Barbie is one of those shitty games, lost in the ocean of shitty games, that fulfilled its purpose of being a shitty game.
Look at Barbie. What a scary bitch.
That quote is nonsensical to begin with, but when revising the video on numerous occasions, GameDude shortened the quote to simply, Barbie is one of those shitty games.
Barbie is one of those shitty games.
What a great book.
You've only read four words, you dumb bitch.
Another one of his videos that received a big revamping was his Bill and Ted's Excellent Video Game Adventure review. In this one, he originally reviewed the game without knowing it was based off of a movie.
I was criticizing Rufus. I was like, you know, who's Rufus? What kind of name is Rufus? Is he a fucking dog? And I criticized the whole, I criticized everything about everything. And then I got all these comments and they're like, they're talking about a movie. They're like, oh, you obviously haven't seen the movie. And I was like, movie? What is he talking about? I never watched the movie. So when I reviewed it, I had no idea what I was talking about. Like, everything that could go wrong in, like, a satirical video, you know, I'll just call them reviews, just for now, like, no, they're not really. Everything that could go wrong in, like, a review went wrong there.
But probably the best example I can give for how crazy this re-editing got was what I like to call the Mario Smash Kart saga. If you remember on my episode list of GameDude reviews, I listed the 5th review as Super Smash Bros. Brawl, the 6th review as Mario Kart, and the 23rd review as Mario Smash Kart. What is Mario Smash Kart? Well, the Brawl and Mario Kart videos were amongst his most revised videos. The Brawl one in particular he re-uploaded well over 50 times and went even further by not just revising, but refilming it. As time went on, Alex admitted his dissatisfaction with both of the videos, starting with the Mario Kart one, which he eventually removed from his channel altogether. However, after doing this, he took about 15 to 20 seconds of the jokes from the video, added them to the end of his Brawl revisions, and continued revising. It doesn't end there. After also expressing dissatisfaction with the Brawl review, Alex removed that video from his channel as well and uploaded a video called Mario Smash Kart. This video is a general overview of the nitpicks of Mario games, usually with the prerequisite question of why.
Mario is the video game king, but like all games, his adventures are not perfect. Why can't I go back? Why do levels repeat? Again, why can't I go back? Where's multiplayer? Why can't I kill jellyfish? Why is 7th castle right by the 8th? Why is Peach's castle an art gallery? Where's Luigi?
But later in the video, Alexander included clips from both his Brawl and Mario Kart reviews, the latter of which was the clips already used in the Brawl revisions.
Is he doing what I think he's doing? I don't believe it. He is! Diddy Kong's bothering Mario! Bastard! That arch and map look like dicks. Peach Beach? More like Peach's fantasy dickland. And if Wario's helping the cart,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Who's steering?
So basically, the Mario Smash Kart video was an amalgamation of new footage and footage from another review, which in itself included footage from another review.
Everybody got that? Good!
I've just given you a basic overview of the things people like to use as fodder against Alexander. Now I really want to get into the community's response to him and examine just how deep the levels of trolling him got to. On top of all the negative comments he would receive on his videos, GameDude was a big topic of discussion in the commentary community back in the day. Not just from trolls, although that was a large component of it, but also from other YouTubers who made commentaries and parodies of the GameDude.
GameDude. Yeah. Apparently this is a game dude. I would have called him the imported reject from Retardistan, but you'll see what I mean soon enough.
Yeah, game dude is another AVGM wannabe who likes to think he's funny and a good actor when really he isn't.
You only play her at the beginning of the game, which is good because she never grows as a character and is just unlikable.
And I have to love that audio editing. It makes me sound like William Shatner. I'm acting!
That arch looks like a giant pink dick. And is it a coincidence that the map is also dick-shaped?
What kind of an undersexed life do you have to lead in order to be able to see dicks everywhere?
I believe my work will be recognized as the best on the internet, because I watch lots of gay boyish porn movies, and learned my directing skills from there, because I have AIDS, and suffer from severe faggotry.
All of this attention Alex was receiving not only caused a lot of commotion on YouTube, but bled over into his personal life. One instance was when Game Deals, a local video store in New Westminster, Alex's hometown, conducted an interview with him at their store. It's pretty obvious from the bizarre questions they were asking him that the interview was conducted mostly to poke fun at him.
Yeah, Game Dude. So, a name so generic it's brilliant. That style, you know, works the most, and, you know, so I pretty much like his videos the most, so that's why I'm more, like, inspired by him than others. I've talked to him a few times, just, like, with only by, like, letters, pretty much, because, you know, every time I try to talk to him on the internet, he never replies. I'm not like some weird, creepy, you know, guy with like a giant picture of the angry video game nerd in my living room that I like. Yeah.
Another case was when one of his classmates at Vancouver Film School ended up sending a private message to one of Game Dude's critics regarding his attendance at VFS. Hi there, I just listened to your rants regarding the Game Dude. I know him personally. He is in my digital design class at Vancouver Film School. He gets no respect from anyone. The course is designed to prepare would-be designers for professional positions in the industry. As far as we are all concerned, he has done nothing but waste his time and money, and this program is in no way cheap or low quality. He has learned some basic skills with green screen, digital compositing, and sound editing, but has not expanded his interests in any way. Same old stupid shit about stupid forgotten video games. He has the potential to do so much but chooses to continue down this ridiculous path, which is why he is dead bottom in the class for quality of work. He is a walking joke and everyone holds his work as being the low watermark for the entire school. Believe me, he doesn't need any more criticism. This snowball effect was further accelerated by the inception of his article on Encyclopedia Dramatica, a website dedicated to harshly lampooning internet culture in an encyclopedic format. Much to Alex's dismay, the article time-capsuled many of the aforementioned points of contention. It got to the point where several people were making YouTube accounts solely dedicated to trolling Alexander. Some trolls went the extra mile and created accounts dedicated not only to simply trolling the Game Dude, but impersonating him. The most notable account that was guilty of this was a channel called Game Dude Official. This was an account that re-uploaded a lot of Game Dude's videos, as well as creating original videos using some of Alexander's clips in an attempt to misrepresent him. One situation this channel got itself into was the Sentinel CL incident. At one point, Alexander released an advertisement for Game Dude DVDs which you could purchase for $5 through a PayPal transaction. I don't know what was on these DVDs, although it was probably some of his revised reviews. Eventually, Alex stopped selling the DVDs and took his advertisement for them down. GameDude Official, on the other hand, re-uploaded the advertisement onto his channel with Alexander's PayPal information. Sentinel CL purchased the DVDs via the advertisement on GameDude Official's channel and released a video later claiming that he never received the DVD.
So I order the DVD. 3 weeks go by, no DVD. I email the GameDude at both his channels, GameDude Official and the other one, Alexander whatever. The PMs never get responded to. So this guy's running from me now. And for what? Over what? Over a $5 DVD? If you couldn't have gotten me the DVD, you could have just refunded me the money. Problem solved.
In response to this, GameDude Official, posing as Alexander, released a video response, not really disputing anything, but instead making fun of Sentinel CL's appearance and the way he presents himself. The video used a text response rather than audio. Alex was known for doing this occasionally on his own channel, so it was not difficult for GameDude Official to keep up this ruse by doing the same thing.
One of the first things you say and you repeat in your video often is that I am, one, fat. Yes, yes, I am fat. Your point? And two, balding. Once again, yeah, I am balding. What's your point? What's this have to do with anything regarding me paying you for a DVD that I never got? But, thank you for the 7 minutes of entertainment on that video. And it's kind of funny. You entertained me for 7 minutes. How long did it take you for all that work in making that video? Waste of time, in my opinion, but you entertained me, so thank you.
Eventually, Alex did respond to Sentinel CL directly through his Alexander 4488 channel, saying that he did not realize GameDude Official still had the advertisement on his page, and subsequently refunded the money.
As may you know, GameDude Official was a troll account. However, my money had went to Alexander Bad Ears account. He did contact me now. He said that he has not been online in a while and more or less left YouTube. And was not aware that there was someone online that still had his commercials up and did not realize I had sent him money into his PayPal account.
As a result of this, the drama subsided, although GameDude Official continued his facade both to confuse the uninitiated and entertain those who were in on the joke. Despite the fact that impersonation is a legitimately actionable offense by YouTube's guidelines, Alexander, to my knowledge anyway, never seemed to take action against him, or anyone else who made videos about him. However, that didn't stop him from responding in other ways. A general rule of thumb when dealing with trolls online is to ignore them. This was not a mindset that Alexander adhered to. Quite the opposite, in fact. GameDude was notorious for responding to damn near every bit of negative feedback that were left on his videos. Especially in the earlier days of his channel, many of his responses to criticism were notably aggressive. This often meant spamming other commentary videos to oblivion with comments. Other times, he would make video responses where he would film himself doing a commentary over another person's commentary in a decidedly over-the-top manner.
One, let's do this. Alright, let's do this. What do we have here?
I remember back...
Okay, first of all, Pikachu. Why Pikachu? Like, why? What do you have some kind of obsession with Pikachu? Whatever. You didn't even criticize my playing the Alvin the Chipmunks theme song in a Brawl review. That doesn't make sense. Why don't you criticize that?
Brawl is a master.
Oh, the acting is horrible.
Wow. Now that is what you call butthurt. Pure butthurt. See, you know what this guy does? This guy, I hate having to make a video response to a comment. Who makes a video response to a comment? You know what a comment is? All a comment is is black pixels displayed on your computer screen. They mean nothing. They're just letters found on your keyboard. That's all comments are. They don't mean anything. And you know what? I don't really care what these trolls have to say, because the angry video game nerd himself complimented my work. So you know what? These trolls can just go fuck off, whatever. But the thing is, sometimes they're right. Sometimes I agree with them.
If you made a YouTube video with either Alexander 4488 or GameDude in the title, Alex was almost guaranteed to find it and respond to it in one way or another. This didn't just happen on YouTube, though. This was also true in his responses to his article on Encyclopedia Dramatica. To give some context, originally GameDude had a small blurb in the video game reviewers page of ED. The blurb reads, "A butthurt game reviewer who is less known for his appallingly bad game reviews and more known for his self-filleting advertisements on every video game website known to man. Like another overly egotistical game reviewer, he goes to film school and fancies himself the second coming of the AVGN on YouTube. Bottom line, he is a disgrace to all video game reviewers and a way bigger AVGN ripoff than the Irate Gamer." Upon finding this blurb, Alexander made an account on Encyclopedia Dramatica to delete the harsh criticisms. ED proceeded to ban him, so GameDude made a second account and tried the same thing. This of course led to a Streisand effect when the admins on Encyclopedia Dramatica decided to expand his small blurb into a full page. Alexander 4488 is a retarded, smug Canadian and wannabe filmmaker who creates pathetic video game reviews with the cliched angry nerd shtick in them on YouTube. He also visits the Vancouver Film School, hoping to become a better director and filmmaker, and promotes himself as the greatest thing on YouTube next to the angry video game nerd, despite the fact he is one of the worst reviewers of all time. He is also a terrorist, treating the video game reviewing community just like the Twin Towers, etc. This didn't deter Alex from continuing to attempt to remove the information on the website. He ended up making over 5 more accounts, all of which were banned for trying to remove the information. In response to this, the admins at ED created another article called the Alexander 4488 Approved ED Page, an article sarcastically praising GameDude. Alexander 4488 is a hilarious and smart Canadian filmmaker who creates wonderful game reviews with the original shtick in them on YouTube. He also visits the Vancouver Film School, hoping to become an even better director and filmmaker. And he is the greatest thing on YouTube next to the Angry Video Game Nerd, despite the fact that many of his reviews are funnier than the nerds. Clearly, Alexander was prone to reacting to things, and the drama surrounding him escalated because of it. However, at one point, on what many of his critics perceived to be an out-of-character action, he issued an apology video addressing a lot of his behavior.
Hello, this is, the Game Dude, and, I think I should, make an, apology, You know, I've been, acting like a douchebag lately. I've been, just swearing at everyone, pretty much, calling them, like, faggots and dumb shits and all that kind of stuff. I've just been, like, I don't know, acting like an asshole, and, I apologize for deleting comments. I've been doing that lately, too. That's just, you know, cowardly, you know, and advertising my videos on other videos. I did that in the past a bit, quite a lot actually. I apologize for that. That was all retarded. I still want to give my, you know, honest opinion on all of these commentaries, but I'm going to do so in a more professional manner in the future. I'm going to, revamp my videos and just try to, make them not shitty kind of thing. And I know you guys don't like my revising my videos, but I do it for the future YouTube users. I do it for, future people that... I do it for those that haven't seen my videos yet.
While this apology didn't stop people from trolling the Game Dude and sometimes getting a reaction from him, his reactions to criticism were a lot less bombastic than before. So for a while, this continued. GameDude kept making reviews and revising his old ones, trolls kept trolling, and commentators kept making commentaries. But in 2010, things would change significantly for Alexander, not on YouTube, but in his personal life.
No, but I'm looking for one. I'm getting a little bit annoyed. I'm 21 and I still don't have one. It's driving me crazy. Well, I want one that's nice, but then again, most of the nice ones are kind of, fat, unfortunately. I'm also looking for, one that looks hot. Then again, a lot of the hot ones are bitches, so it's like really, you gotta find one in the middle, and that's the trick. You gotta find one in the middle. Yeah, just, she's gotta have like big tits and nice ass, and she's gotta be...
To the surprise of many, a few months after that interview was posted, Alexander's love life improved. He met a girl named Alana on a dating website called Tagged. This was Alex's very first relationship in his life. Soon, GameDude's viewers became aware of Alana's existence as she would start to appear in the Alexander 4488 channel. In these videos, Alana would do box art reviews that would critique the cover art of games such as God of War and Bioshock. Her presence on the channel in association with Alexander did make her the subject of trolling in the comments of these videos, especially when they were re-uploaded onto different accounts such as GameDude Officials. However, this didn't seem to detract from the relationship at the time. He had spoken to fans through Skype, Facebook, and other platforms about how well it was going. This change in his personal life also seemed to make a change in the content he was uploading. While he kept making reviews and revising his old ones, he also decided to branch out from the angry reviewer routine and release some more experimental videos.
You know what's goose poop? Sports games. Why are there so many of them? Why do we need 50 new football games every fucking year?
To start this section off, let's look at GameDude's video interactions with the two YouTubers he took the most notes from, the Angry Video Game Nerd and the Irate Gamer. Starting with the AVGN, Alexander released videos showing letters which he had written to James Rolfe and the replies which were sent back to him.
So a lot of people have been, wondering, what does the Angry Video Game Nerd think of my GameDude show? He likes my show? If you don't believe me, ask him yourself, but only if you have to.
The video is no longer available in its entirety, but I remember it detailing that apparently Rolf had seen GameDude's Barbie review, and that Alexander sent James the Famicom, which he would eventually use in the AVGN Transformers episode. Alexander also stated in the video that if anybody questioned the legitimacy of the letters, they could ask James himself. And at the Screw Attack Gaming Convention of 2010, someone did exactly that.
First question, have you ever heard of Alexander 4488, and what do you think about it?
What's it called?
Alexander 4488.
No. What do you think of it?
Let's just say he's a big fan of you.
Okay.
He's crazy.
Alex later responded to this video by releasing a video showing an email which he received from James regarding the incident. In the email, James states that the reason he responded the way that he did is because the person asking the question said Alexander4488, and Rolf didn't remember the username. If the person had said GameDude instead, according to the email, Rolf would have known. Someone who is undoubtedly aware of GameDude's existence, however, was Chris Bors. During his time on YouTube, Alexander made several videos ranting about the Irate Gamer's show, criticizing factual errors in the Irate Gamer videos, amongst other things.
You know, just one review. I want to see just one review from the Irate Gamer with no flaws. Just one. That's all I ask. I just finished watching his Donkey Kong Country Returns review, and although there weren't too many flaws, there were still a few big ones, like he said some of the new moves are Donkey Kong's ground pound, which is incorrect because Donkey Kong can ground pound in Donkey Kong Country. And then he said Diddy Kong can fly in a jetpack. He said that's one of the new moves as well, which is also incorrect because Diddy Kong can fly in a jetpack in Donkey Kong 64. Oh, by the way, Irate Gamer referred to Rambi as, what do you, I think he said like Animal Friend or something. Like, does he not know the name of Rambi? Kind of like the time when he just called Abu a monkey in Aladdin. Like, so many times it seems like Irate Gamer doesn't know the names of, like, certain video game characters, which, yeah, is kind of sad, but whatever.
Chris Bors admitted on Facebook that he eventually blocked Alex from his YouTube channel because of the constant self-promotion spam he was leaving in his comments. GameDude might be compared to me because he does a lot of special effects in his reviews and his production values are better than others, and the lingo he chooses to use. It's no surprise he was very much inspired by me and James Rolf. Though Rolf gets the credit in his videos, I do not, which is kind of funny. Overall, I used to like his work, but I'm getting a little tired of it. I did have to block him because he was spamming my YouTube comments with adverts to his own videos. Eventually, Alexander decided to confront Bors about this through Facebook and then uploaded a video revealing the conversation.
Oh boy, oh boy. So yeah, I'm just talking to the real Chris Bors on Facebook and just watch. So, you know, I'm just talking to him and just, I don't know, I'm just, like, asking him, like, why he blocked me. He's like, oh, you're spamming, blah, 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 blah. And, oh, that was a fake apology I gave to him, by the way. And then I'm like, yeah, the get me a sandwich joke is, the get me a sandwich bitch joke is hilarious. And he's like, my jokes are supposed to be lame. A sandwich is lame. I don't know, and then, yeah, man, like, this guy never learns, does he? He just never learns.
Clearly, the GameDude wasn't a big fan of the Irate Gamer. Like many others, he took issues with Chris's continued inability to address James publicly. Also, since many of the GameDude's critics tended to lump GameDude and Irate Gamer together as AVGN ripoffs, Alexander wanted to distance himself from that label.
It's been a while. Now, I'm not one to do the whole retro review thing. As you know, it's a bit overdone on the internet.
He made the following statements about the comparisons he was getting. Why am I being grouped in with epic failures such as Irate Gamer, Spax 3, Silent Rob, Navigator, and NC17 Productions? Especially the Irate Gamer who knows less about video games than a chimpanzee wearing a helmet and a reject of the typewriting kind. I think comparing me to Boars is pretty retarded. I don't make retarded mistakes. I believe my humor, acting, and writing, although not fantastic, is far superior. I'm not racist, only interested in money, pretend my inspiration doesn't exist, etc. However, he also decided to throw a curveball to the people accusing him for sucking up to James Rolfe. He released a clip comparison video between the Angry Video Game Nerd's review of Rob the Robot with the Irate Gamer's review of the same accessory. He showed similar clips of dialogue between the two videos, implying that Rolfe may have plagiarized from the Irate Gamer.
The robot alone needs four AA batteries to work. Then on top of that, you'll need a single D battery for one of the accessories.
They come with a spinner, which takes a D battery. Top of the four double A's you'll need for Rob. They come with a spinner which takes a D battery. On top of the four double A's you'll need for Rob.
The robot alone needs four double A batteries to work. Then on top of that, you'll need a single D battery for one of the accessories.
But GameDude wasn't just ruffling feathers in the YouTube community. As mentioned earlier, Alexander was a student of Vancouver Film School, taking courses in digital design and later acting. He released a few of the digital design tests publicly on his YouTube channel, but that was nothing compared to his acting projects. I played the Burger King ad earlier, but Alex also posted more of his acting projects around this time. Some of these videos are too bizarre to even describe, so I'll just play a couple to give you an idea of what they were like.
Welcome back to The Nelson Show. Now, unfortunately, during this time of year, many people suffer from a form of depression known as SAD, seasonal affective disorder. With us here today to help us understand a little bit more about this particular mood disorder is famous psychiatrist Dr. Frank Welker. Frank, thanks for being with us on the show today.
My pleasure, Nelson. Thank you.
Now, Dr. Welker, what can you tell us about SAD?
Well, Nelson, seasonal affective disorder is basically the result of diminishing sunlight that we experience during the winter months. Basically, animals react to it through hibernation, whereas human beings, we start feeling inactive or overdrawn.
Fascinating. Now, what can people do to alleviate these symptoms?
One of the most promising ways to counteract SAD is through light therapy. Basically, get away from the darkness, you know, go toward the light. We recommend using fluorescent light, though, as it reacts just like outdoor sunshine. But if you're on any medication, we do recommend you consult your physician.
Thank you.
The important thing to remember, though, Nelson, is that winter does not last forever. The days are already getting longer, and before you know it, spring will be here soon.
Well, thanks again, Dr. Welker, for taking time to come onto the show and telling us about SAD.
My pleasure, Nelson. Thank you.
GameDude didn't completely deviate from the topic of video games, though. In addition to his reviews, he started doing off-the-cuff, unscripted vlog-style videos which discussed games in a more free-form discussion style.
Oh boy. I'm gonna, review a game right now. Yep! Right now. I am gonna review... What the hell am I gonna review? I don't know, what should I review? How about the Sonic Adventure games? Yeah, you know, those games are fucking awesome, man.
Today, I am going to talk about Jak and Daxter. That game is awesome.
They've ruined Ratchet now, too. Thanks a lot. Yay! They've ruined Ratchet now, too. His newest game, yeah, it sucks. And he sucks in PlayStation Move Heroes. And that game itself sucks.
By far, my favorite part of the videos is the way he opens each one.
Hey, how's it going? It's the Game Dude! Hey, how's it going? It's the Game Dude!
Hey, how's it going? It's the Game Dude!
Hello. And how do you do?
Alexander continued producing content consistently for a while, but by 2012 his output had started to slow down in many regards. He would continue revising his older reviews, much to his fans' annoyance, but newer Game Dude reviews were becoming scarcer and shorter. His last two reviews, Donald Duck Going Quackers and Ratchet & Clank Size Matters, were only about a minute and a half long each, and he didn't even appear on camera in the latter one. The Size Matters review, posted near the end of 2012, ended up being the final episode of the Game Dude show. Unbeknownst to him or his audience at the time, 2013 was going to mark a dramatic change for Game Dude's personal life and content. A lot of what happened in the following few months is sparsely documented, and I no longer have access to a lot of the content I'm about to talk about. So, I'm going to give you a summary of the events the way that I remember them unfolding. In early 2013, the troll channel GameDude Official uploaded a video showing private messages he received from two people. One was a troll named Sheepman, obviously named after the sheep meme that GameDude was known for, and the other was from Alexander4488. The message from Sheepman claimed that he made a fake profile on Tagged, the dating website where Alexander met Alana. He then proceeded to have a conversation with Alana, screen cap the results, and send it to Alexander on Facebook. Sheepman then showed a screen cap of Alexander's response to him on Facebook. I forget the exact wording of the message, but to paraphrase from my memory, "Great. Why did you do that? Did you think it was funny? Now she's gone forever. I want to fucking die." After showing this message, GameDude Official showed the message he received from Alexander4488. In these messages, Alexander falsely accused GameDude Official of being the person who spoke to Alana untagged, and threatened to take action against a GameDude Official if he did not remove the videos of Alana on his account, as he re-uploaded her box art reviews onto his channel. Alexander then proceeded to private all of the videos on his Alexander4488 channel, and posted a message saying closed forever for privacy reasons. Shortly after this, the conversation between Sheepman and Alana was posted onto GameDude's Encyclopedia Dramatica page. This I still do have access to. It reads as follows. Impressive. A beautiful girl like you should have been snatched up a long time ago. Wanna make out sometime this week? Okay. Perfect. What's your number, babe? Wanna come over to my house this Friday and make love? I'm free on Friday. If you want, we can go for coffee or something. I don't go to people's houses if I've never met them before. Wanna make love in my house after coffee? Okay, maybe. Cool. What's your phone number? When and where do you want to meet today? What about 4 at Starbucks? Okay, what Starbucks? The one at Broadway and McDonald? Sounds good. Still want to make love at my house after? Maybe. Why maybe? because I don't know you very well. So what do I have to do? Nothing. If you acknowledge that I am a nice guy after coffee, would that maybe be a yes? Yeah, yes. Yes or for sure. For sure. Perfect. How do you feel about open relationships? They are fine sometimes. Sleeping with anyone at the moment? No. How many guys have you met off of Tagged? 2. What happened to them? I'm still friends with them. How many guys have you slept with in the past 4 months? 1. Why are you guys just friends now? 1 lives far away and the other I'd rather just be friends with. Why is that? I don't like him as more than a friend. What did he do? Nothing, we have different personalities. Are you good at giving blowjobs? I don't know. Will I be the hottest guy you've ever fucked? No, probably not. Are you looking for a boyfriend at all? Yeah, if I find the right person. How often would we be able to hang out every week? Probably only once a week. Out of all the guys you've slept with, how many have given you an orgasm? Only 1. Babe, tonight I'm gonna give you multiple orgasms. What do you think about that? That would be good. So, no feelings left for that guy you want to be just friends with? No, not really. So how many guys have you slept with that are hotter than I? Maybe 2. Have any naked pics you could send me? No, I don't do that. I have to go now. See you at 4, babe. Bye. 4 o'clock sharp. Not a minute late, please. Bye.
The drama that Game Dude got himself into on YouTube now had negatively affected his personal life in a substantial manner. So much, though, that it seemed to mark an end for him both on YouTube and his first relationship. But as his viewers would soon find out, he wasn't quite ready to give up on either. A few days to a week after this incident, Alexander reopened his YouTube channel and continued posting revisions of his reviews. At the time, viewers were unaware of exactly what was unraveling in his personal life or what became of the relationship with Alana. Shortly after his YouTube channel seemingly returned to normal, GameDude uploaded a bizarre video onto his account. The video in question was of seagulls on Kitsilano Beach in Vancouver, with John Lennon's Imagine playing in the background. Soon after this, he took down the video and re-uploaded it, this time intercutting footage of him lip-syncing to the song with the footage of the seagulls. Imagine all the people living
for today. The video ended up being taken down for copyright infringement, as Alexander played the song in its entirety. But he wasn't done from making lip-sync videos yet. Soon after, he released another one, but for this one, he dedicated it to Alana. I'm not sure if he dedicated the video to her in an effort to win her heart back or to troll her, as Alex has made contradicting statements regarding the intent. Knowing him, it was probably a little bit of both. What I do know for certain is that Alana had a response to the video. GameDude's title card artist, DeviantArt artist GalvanizationX, sent the video to Alana via Facebook, and her reaction was less than flattered. Wow, he is really screwed up. He's so obsessed, I think he follows me, and he keeps phoning me. He's such a creep. Yeah, tell him to leave me alone or I'll call the police. I already did file a police report. I'm not joking, okay? He needs to stop thinking it's a joke. This seemed to spark an effect in Alexander because the following day after releasing his Rick Astley video, the Alexander 4488 channel was deleted from YouTube. Since there is no way of reversing the decision to shut down a channel, Alexander 4488 was no more, his channel having gone out not with a bang, but with a Rick roll. Objection! I have to be very careful about how I talk about this next bit of information. As mentioned earlier, Alana filed a police report against Alexander around this time, but this was only one of several. GameDudes and viewers eventually became aware of what was detailed in these reports because Alexander made them public for everyone to see. Not just the reports though, he also posted other information, including other court documents, a video of Alana being interviewed by the police, a 911 call, and witness interviews. This information was later pulled down when someone who was being legally represented by the Crown Prosecution Service sent messages threatening legal action against anyone hosting the content. For that reason, I will not be revealing Alana's identity here beyond her first name, nor will I be playing any videos, pictures, or audio of her. I will also not be showing or quoting word for word what was in the legal documents, although I do have access to them. As detailed in the court documents, shortly after the interaction with Sheepman on Tag, Alexander began to do everything he could to resolve things between him and Alana. Alana wanted no part of it, which only encouraged Alexander to try harder. This resulted in a myriad of different incidents leading to Alana and her mother calling the police on 4 separate times regarding Alexander's behavior. These actions included Alex calling Alana's house repeatedly from several different phone numbers, sometimes up to 60 times on certain days, sending dozens of long critical emails to her, following her home from her bus stop, attempting to physically restrain her from entering her building, interacting with neighbors and family members, breaking no contact orders, hovering around the neighborhood for hours almost every single day for several months, ringing the buzzer of their apartment frequently, and hiding in Alana's bushes waiting to talk to her as she leaves her apartment building. All of this, in conjunction with the aforementioned Rick Astley video and the now publicly available tagged conversation, were leading to an upcoming court case which Alana filed against Alexander under the charges of stalking and harassment. These incidents continued throughout 2013, but Alana wasn't the only thing that he was dedicating his time to. Shortly after his original Alexander4488 account was deleted, GameDude made an odd return to YouTube. Unbeknownst to many at the time, Alexander started posting on another channel. I remember finding the channel back in the day. The videos posted there received barely any views at the time, only about 10 to 30 views per video. Also, he wasn't uploading his GameDude reviews onto his channel. The videos he was posting tended to be strange and ominous. Unfortunately, I do not have access to a lot of these videos, but thankfully, I remember them well enough to describe them. The most frequent subject of these videos was filming wildlife, possibly stemming from the original Imagine video where he filmed the seagulls on the beach. One video I remember in particular was a video of him finding an injured crow, picking it up in a box, and taking it to an animal hospital where they ended up having to euthanize it. After this video, he filmed more wildlife, sometimes silently, sometimes talking to the animals, sometimes talking about something irrelevant, and sometimes with video game music playing in the background.
Hey, want some chocolate? Look. Chocolate goose. Chocolate. Hello, lizard. Hello. How do you do, lizard?
Beyond his animal videos, other videos I remember seeing around this time were a video of two people arguing in front of a McDonald's about whether someone needs consent to have their photo taken, a video of a fight breaking out in a local store, an hour and a half redux of his original 30-minute platform rant, another platform rant about the lack of 3D platformers in the overabundance of 2D ones, a rant about Subway for having to customize your sandwich instead of being able to order pre-made ones. No, I'm not kidding. And a rant about people inverting their emotions instead of venting them.
That's it, you little fucking son of a bitch. Right now.
Speaking of venting your emotions, Alexander did exactly that when it came to the police. After having the police called on him several times, Alexander was convinced that the police had it out for him. In retaliation to this, he started to post videos of him fucking with the police.
Shia, what is your badge number?
2355.
And yours?
You can read, right?
Free to tape all you want. How long is it going to go? Just curious.
After posting that initial video, he made a second one. One night, he believed the police were monitoring him as he was walking around downtown Vancouver, so he decided it was time for the hunters to become the hunted.
Stop it. Stop the fucking car, you little fuck! Come on, stop the car! The fuck! Come on, you little fuck nugget! Come on! Piece of fuck! Yeah, now what, huh? Well, get back here, you fuck! Oh, bitch! Get the fuck out of here! Fucking piece of shit!
You keep following me, I'll call the police and get you on stalking. Now get the fuck out of here.
He's gonna call the police on the police. I wonder how that went for him. But Game Dude wasn't just active on YouTube. Like he had done with Circumcision, Alexander posted, again using his Alexander4488 username, on a support forum for people who have been cheated on in relationships. His post on truthaboutdeception.com reads as follows. A girl and I promised to only sleep with each other, and that automatically made us boyfriend and girlfriend for removing the titles Alter Nothing. I discovered a conversation that revealed she had agreed to sleep with a complete stranger and a total loser. I even found her at the location where they planned to meet. He never showed up, but attempted cheating is still cheating. She told me that she wasn't really going to sleep with him, but should I believe her, and if not, should I forgive her? He then proceeds to post a shortened transcript of the tagged conversation. Although Alexander never responded to this blog after making this post, he did get some very passionate responses from people, most of whom encouraged him to forget about Alana, with others mocking the conversation. Seriously? So you and this girl decided, hey, let's promise to only sleep with each other. And that's how you guys validated being boyfriend and girlfriend? Sorry, buddy, but I'm not even sure if there is a foundation for this relationship. What I am sure is, your girl is messed up. You're just as messed up choosing someone like her who talks and plans to meet up and have sex with strangers. That conversation was just ghetto. Sorry. Okay, so you want to know if you should believe or forgive her? Hell no. In fact, dump her ass and go find friends who will guide you to make better choices in life. Sorry to sound so harsh. This thread has "To Catch a Predator" written all over it. Chris Hansen, is that you? Trust me, I've been there and heard that before. I am not touching this one. Way too out there for me from start to finish. It is what it is. Life is just too damn short.
Mickey Mouse.
One other notable thing that happened in 2013 was that the Let's Play YouTube channel Game Grumps released a video of them playing Mickey Mousecapade. In the video, they mockingly mimic a YouTuber that they were watching prior to recording their video. They cite a YouTuber as a Let's Player who was doing a bad impression of the angry video game nerd.
What is this bullshit? Two cats? Why not three? Jeez, what were they thinking? This game's a bunch of poopy ass dicks. Covered in chocolate feces. What is this? Some kind of angel? I don't want religion in my game.
Viewers of the Game Grumps naturally searched for the video, with most people linking the probable culprit to be the Game Dude's review of Mickey Mousecapade.
Now rather than be a generic platformer buried in a mountain of other generic platformers, this fucker wanted to be creative. So Minnie sniffs your farts throughout the entire game, copying your every move and following your ass like Tails does with Sonic. She is the scourge of the universe.
Many people found this to be an obvious choice given the nature of the Game Grumps' impressions. But despite this, Aaron of the Game Grumps later disputed on Reddit that this was not actually the person who he and Dan were parodying. As 2013 rolled into 2014, Alexander's court date was coming closer. He even spoke with many of his fans on Skype about the upcoming case and the incidents with Alana. And as the date approached, Alexander decided he wasn't going to take it anymore. This is when he released, for everyone to see, his side of the story.
I have no fucking words. No fucking words. Shut up.
Alexander chronicled his experiences with Alana in two ways. One was on a blog he ran called The Truth, and the other was a series of videos he posted called The Alana Story. Both of these are extremely lengthy. The blog is the length of a literal novel, and the videos, released in four parts, altogether clock in at a little bit over an hour and 45 minutes. The blog is also where Alex posted many of the legal documents relating to the case. For this reason, and for the sake of brevity, I'm going to be using the videos as the main point of reference for this story, while occasionally calling attention to the blogs for more context. GameDude begins his story by recalling an event which occurred between him and Alana at a nightclub. According to him, at this point, they were in an open relationship.
We were exclusive for 3 years. We were in an open relationship for a while, which was really weird. A club, you know, dancing with all the girls, and then by major fluke, there's Alana. Hey, how's it going? I'm like, oh, hey, Alana. I'm dancing intimately with these girls. I'm like, she stole the spotlight. This girl is fucking beautiful, right? Fuck these girls. or don't fuck these girls. I'm gonna go dance with Alanis, you know. Next thing you know, I see her with some fucking asshole. His arm is around her, right? I'm like, who the fuck is this guy? Fuck you, buddy. I'm gonna get her away from you. I don't give a fuck. She can fuck other guys away from me. She's like shy, right? I'm trying to get her away from this guy. I'm like, come on, Alana, come on, let's go dance. And next thing you know, fucking bouncers kick me out. I'm like, what the fuck? I'm fucking go batshit fucking insane. Fucking yelling outside, please come and talk to me. I take a taxi, go to her house, fucking climb over the gate, knock on her door. I'm like, what the fuck, fuck, fuck? She's like, I was on a date. And I'm like, he was your date. He wasn't some random guy that was flirting with you. You couldn't have told me this. Oh, I didn't want to hurt your feelings. Were we not in an open relationship? Hello?
After being embarrassed by the incident at the club, Alex no longer wanted the relationship to be open. He told Alana he wanted a closed relationship again, which she allegedly agreed to.
And I'm like, no, fuck you. Or don't fuck you, because I am sick and tired of this open relationship bullshit. No. I want to be just friends. And she's like, oh, how come you don't want to sleep with me? Am I ugly? Mwah, mwah. Then eventually I was like, okay, fine. All right. But no more open relationship, just me and you. We're going to be in a closed relationship again. That's it. She's like, okay, fine, I promise. I will only sleep with you. I don't even want to kiss other guys. She's like crying, you know, like begging. And then I'm like, okay, fine, but just me and you. That's it.
Not long after this conversation is when Sheepman messaged Alexander the tagged conversation on Facebook.
A few days later, guess what? All right, Alana has a tagged account. So do I. Tagged is a dating site. Alana was like my only friend on Tagged, and I linked my Tagged account on my YouTube channel. Then this troll, Sheepman? I guess the troll goes to my channel and, hey, what's this? Let's check out this link. Oh, it's a dating site called Tagged. It only has one friend. Alana! Oh yeah, I remember. Yeah, Alana reviewed two games on my channel. God of War 2 and Bioshock. Well, the box art for those games. Anyway, she's kind of known on YouTube. The troll's like, let's test Game Dude's girlfriend's loyalty! Starts snacking on her and then screen caps the conversation, sends it to me on Facebook. I'm reading it and I'm in utter fucking disbelief at this fucking shit. Utter disbelief. Okay, the guy is like, beautiful girl like you should have been snatched up a long time ago. And then, you know, guess what Alana's like? Oh, no. Then he's like, wanna make out sometime this week? Okay. What the fuck? Are you fucking kidding me? Hey, baby, wanna make out? Okay. And then she's like, let's meet at Starbucks at 4:00. Okay, shit just got fucking real. Then he's like, how many guys gave you an orgasm? She's like, only one. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge, that's besides the point. Then he's like, babe, tonight I'm gonna be giving you multiple orgasms. What do you think about that? She's like, sounds good. It's the most unrealistic, fucked up conversation I have ever fucking seen. Like, what the fuck?
Enraged by this, he went to confront Alana at the supposed meeting location.
I went batshit fucking insane. I print that conversation. I go to that Starbucks and I waltz right in there. I drop the conversation. I say, this ends our friendship. I walk out. I wish that was the end.
Following this, Alexander proceeded to call Alana repeatedly until he got through to her. She explained that she did not actually want a closed relationship.
They keep hanging up. I keep calling. Finally, Alana picks up the phone and I say, you promised me, just you and me. She's like, oh, I only said that because you were bugging me. Phew. know? There's only so much stupid a fucking man can endure before he fucking goes batshit fucking insane. What the mother?
Because of this, Alexander believes Alana raped him.
Boy, that escalated quickly. I mean, that really got out of hand fast.
Apparently, by not knowing of her other sexual partners, he believes that Alana is guilty of rape by deception. He provides a link to a definition of rape by deception in his blog. The person giving consent must know about the health risks of that activity. Consent given after a lie about the sexual nature of the activity or the risks of the activity isn't valid if the lie exposes the partner to a significant risk of serious physical harm. If she doesn't care about loyalty, and all you have to do to have sex with her is ask, and her tagged profile had over 11,000 views, imagine how many guys she would have or already had sex with behind my back. The guy that never showed up, because he was a troll, was so creepy and invasive. If you're going to eat the worst apple in the barrel, why won't you eat every apple in the barrel? Imagine how many STDs she could have given me when I thought she was loyal. Was there not a significant risk of serious harm? We would have had sex numerously if I had not seen the conversation. Therefore, she is either a rapist or an attempted rapist had she not already technically raped me when we got intimate and French kissed in her room after the lie. Even if it's far-fetched to call it rape or even sexual assault, I still feel violated by my first love and best friend for around 3 years. Alexander explains that the police had contacted him telling him to stay away from Alana. Since Alex had recently moved into the same neighborhood as Alana shortly before the incident occurred, he found non-interaction with Alana to be impossible. In his blog, he uses visual diagrams to clarify what happened, one of which used Pac-Man characters. He claims most of the incidents with him either running into Alana or being spotted around her apartment were major flukes, a phrase he repeats often in the video and the blog.
And then by major fluke, there's Alana, hey, how's it going? I'm like, oh, hey, Alana. And then she's like, oh, yeah, I was stalking her too. And then, because I mean, well, all right, running into her, well, the first two times, yeah, genuine flukes, alright?
Despite the no contact order, Alana apparently changed her mind when Alex told her he had a new girlfriend. She apparently set a day to meet with Alex and his new girlfriend, but then canceled, causing Alex to become paranoid.
So, 5 months. Get her down to 1 month. Get her down to 1 week. I made her jealous. I was like, I have a girlfriend now. She's like, oh, no, no, you don't. Okay, fine, I'll hang out with you, but you have to bring your girlfriend. And I'm like, okay. Next week goes by. I can't hang out. I'm sick. Are you actually sick or are you just saying that? No, I'm actually sick. I'm like, bullshit. She never wants to see me again. It's all fucked up. I'm fucking batshit insane. I live 10 minute walk away from her house. Just walking, walking. I walk to de-stress, right? I'm fucked. So much confusion. Is she sick or did she change her mind about wanting to see me again? So many questions. I'm still bottling fucking Satan, right? I'm just walking, walking. Fucking nighttime, I run into her. I'm like, Alana, she left me in the dark. Alana, like, what is going on? Just tell me, please. Just tell me what is going on. She's like, I'll call you later. Avoiding me like the fucking plague. Like, I'm fucking going fucking insane. Like, what the fuck? Right? She walks away, calling, calling, nothing, 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 calling, nothing, nothing, nothing. I run into her at night, and then again the following morning, she thinks I'm stalking her. Totally. So many questions, right? I thought our friendship was reviving, right? So, I mean, I try to, like, I'm like, oh, shit, it's Alana, what the fuck? I'm like, okay, I'll hide. Then I was like, nah, that'll be fucking creepy, you know? Seeing me trying to hide, I was like, ah, fuck it. I'm like, Alana, she never ran. She never vocally or physically informed me to go away. She emoted it, but that was it.
After this, Alex received a second call from the police and an email from Alana saying that she was ready to move on. Upon this, Alex, by his own admission, overreacted and started trying to win her back any way he could. This included sending her 45 extremely long emails criticizing her actions, stopping her on the street for answers, and several days of excessive phone calls. Alana allegedly replied to him on a few occasions, which in Alex's mind, nullified the no-contact order. Alex makes a side note ranting about other people who he had cut off contact with. Here we see how deep the hatred he had towards his parents for getting him circumcised really was. In his blog, he even links to the Penn & Teller bullshit episode about circumcision in one of the footnotes.
Fuck Alana, fuck Jonathan, fuck Wahid, all three. They were my closest friends. They're all fucked off. And my family. I never want to see them again either. Especially my parents circumcising me. No, 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 no. Fuck you. That was mine. Fuck you. Fucking what? Strapping my legs apart when I was a baby? What the fuck?
It makes it like 90% worse. It's there for a reason.
Oh, mankind's been doing it for thousands of years.
Well, guess what? Mankind's fucking retarded. Are you fucking stupid? No, that's fucking retarded, man. You fucking asked me when I'm an adult, and you know what I would say? Tell that doctor to go, that butcher, to go fuck himself.
You know, when you're a baby, so it wouldn't hurt.
Well, I wouldn't have had it done, you fucking... Should have been my choice. Fuck.
She didn't have any other close friends, and now I know why nobody likes her. The few close friends I ever had all eventually revealed themselves to be pieces of shit that I never want to see again. The last three took their masks off almost simultaneously, leaving me stuck in hell alone. 'Twas the hoe that triggered the domino effect. May karma rape every piece of shit that ever hurt me. Alex then says he repressed his angry emotions in an attempt to peacefully continue living in the same neighborhood as Alana. He referred to this act as bottling Satan. Another one of his choice phrases along with Major Floop. She totally freaked me out and provoked me while I was still bottling Satan in a thin glass jar. Because I was trying to do my best to make peace and had just given her a handwritten apology letter and a diamond ring, the jar exploded and Satan was released. She scolded me and tried to get away with it by walking away and ordering me not to follow her. Was she going to keep playing this childish game? I had to stand up for myself. I apologized for everything. At least be nice to me. Why do you still hate me? I asked. You're a psychopath, she hypocritically replied. Alex states at one point he attempted to overdose on Advil in a suicide attempt, although he admits that he knew the dosage wouldn't have been enough to kill him.
The no contact rule for 1 month. Called her. I was drunk. So nervous. I got drunk to suppress the energy. Stupidest thing I ever did. Called her. She's like, stay the hell away from me. Fucking snapped. Called her a billion times. Got so depressed. Took 10 Advil tablets, thought it would do the trick. Yeah, dude, I was fucked.
Game Dude also kept the theme of his reviews by including animal analogies in his rants.
It's like you fucking slap a monkey on its face and then the monkey slaps you back. And then you hate that monkey. Oh, the monkey slapped me. Get away from me. I wonder why the monkey slapped you. What did you do to the monkey? Look at yourself to understand the monkey. Look at yourself to understand me. Just... I go fucking insane.
The rest of the videos are mostly him repeating himself, so I'd just like to highlight two of the funniest aspects of the vlogs for me. One is when he gets into arguments with crows. I guess the birds were angry at him for taking their brother to the vet to get euthanized.
Shut up. First love. We start intimately dancing and kissing and all that kind of stuff, and she's being all shy. I'm like, fuck, shut up. And like, I thought she was being shy. I wanted you shut the damn. Okay. Rape by deception? You shut up. I don't know. What the fuck are they doing, those crows? She took advantage of my trust. Total betrayal. You guys, shut up!
But funnier than that are his reactions to people when they walk by.
I can't escape this fucking planet. I want to leave this fucking planet. Making a video. Can you climb it and not knock it down, maybe?
Okay, maybe this way. I'm not sure how can I climb this. This way.
Yeah, I could peek out upside down.
Yeah, try.
Close.
Very close. Cool. Bye bye. Oh no, more humans. Oh god. You're looking at me like I'm crazy.
One thing I can say for certain, as it's been a point of confusion, is that he filmed this vlog in Vancouver. Being a local Vancouverite myself, I decided to do a bit of investigative journalism. The area which he filmed this video at was Kitsilano Beach. I went to see if I could find exactly where it happened. The tide was up this day a lot more in the video, but following the skylines, I'd say he filmed the video somewhere around here. I wouldn't be surprised if this rock right here is where he put his camera. Also, look, did somebody spray paint this artwork as a tribute to Game Dude? I guess we'll never know for certain.
I have no fucking words. No fucking words.
I have no fucking words. No fucking words.
Anyway, when he was done filming and editing this whole ordeal, GameDude sent these videos and the blog to all of his contacts on Skype. Responses to him were largely negative, with many commenting that he came across as unhinged and obsessive. In retaliation to this, Alexander removed his videos and replaced them with a 2-hour long video called The Comedy of Being Cheated On, which, as the title suggests, tells the story in a more lighthearted manner. Did this help his case from the people calling him unhinged and obsessive? Well...
This is me. That's Lena. I'm grinding this girl at a club. By major fluke, there's Alana. She says, hey. And then I say, whoa. Just come, you know. Yo. You gotta get out of here. Yep. Time for you to go, buddy. And I'm like, I want to make out? She's not gonna reply. Okay. Interesting. I was bugging you by refusing to fuck you? Well, nobody refuses to fuck me and gets away with it. So my new boyfriend, oh my god, he took me to Disneyland. He's so bad. And then he played the guitar for me. And he forced me to listen. Because he asked me to listen, he forced me to listen. And then, oh my god, he proposed for me. He forced me to listen to him propose to me. Why is my voice getting all weird? Why do I sound like Stuart from Mad TV? Oh my god, why'd you hit me? Oh my god, oh my god, why'd you hit me?
Following his epic dinosaur documentary, and yes, it really was 2 hours long, GameDude once again pulled the video and released a third video called A Message to Alana. I no longer have access to this video, but from what I remember is that it was another retelling of events, this time with audio only, with Alexander breaking down and crying at several points in the video. Much like the other videos, it included arguing with crows and tangents about circumcision. These videos, while similar in content, vary in the emotional perspective from which Alexander presents his story. The first video is anger, the second video is comedy, and the third video is sadness. Personally, I can't help but find it funny that after all this time, GameDude is still doing revisions. One other video Alex kept re-uploading around this time was a video of the cheating conversation being played over audio from Alana's police interview tape claiming she did not cheat on him. Now with the story out there in the open, all GameDude had left to do was to go to court and defend himself. But then, he made a move which nobody predicted.
So, this is me. I'm letting it out for the world to know. I'm tired of bottling shit. I don't want to fucking bottle shit anymore. I'm done with the Game Dude show. Moving on to...
The details of what exactly happened next are hazy, so I'll do my best to piece together everything that I understand regarding the situation. One small point Alexander mentions in both his blog and his message to Alana video is that around this time, with everything going on, he had become homeless due to his roommate assaulting him with a frying pan. One day, my roommate assaulted me with a frying pan, so I ran away and became homeless. I chose not to move elsewhere because I hated being watched by the police. I had ceased all contact with my family, so when my mom went to the house, she discovered I wasn't there anymore and called the police to report that I was missing, which made them believe that I was running away from court. Because of her, I also had to fight a breach of recognizance. We knew at the time that the court case was very close to happening, but whether the court would have ruled in favor of Alexander or not, we will never know, because around this time, Alexander decides to flee the country. Yes, no longer feeling safe in Vancouver, Alexander, presumably by bus, travels down the west coast of America, making stops in Las Vegas and Los Angeles before settling in Mexico. According to Alexander in messages he sent to people around this time, he did go to court, where Alana had an emotional breakdown and ran out of the courtroom. Following this, the case was dismissed, and he fled the country out of fear of further prosecution. A few months later, the takedown messages were sent to GameDude Official and other people hosting his content, Alexander deleted his second channel, and his online presence diminished. And then? I'm not really sure. Alexander did briefly reappear on Skype in late 2015. He relayed messages to people saying that he had moved to Hong Kong at some point. After this brief reappearance, GameDude hasn't been heard from since. But he's definitely been heard about. In 2016, a Vancouver-based short film called Deal Breakers was posted onto YouTube. People took note of this short film for one specific reason. It opened up with a scene featuring none other than Alexander. The release of this film led many to believe that GameDude had returned to Vancouver. However, going onto the YouTube page hosting the film reveals that they released a trailer for this short back in 2012. This trailer includes clips from the film, including a brief clip of the scene with Alexander, proving that while the film was released in 2016, GameDude scenes were filmed well before he left the country. After this, not much has been heard regarding the GameDude. In 2017, former YouTuber Mr. Medeker released a video regarding the events that took place, exposing the story of what happened to GameDude to a larger audience. Also, despite the Game Grumps apparently not actually referring to him, GameDude has been directly mentioned in other Let's Plays by 1EOG and Super Mega.
I sound like the fucking GameDude over here.
Why do they all look the same?
Fucking stupid! It's fucking
boomy ass dick!
It's fucking gay ass dookie dude!
This game is an ass shit pile of fuck!
What is the worst song you would want to hear as you're leaving death row, as you're going to the chair?
To going to die?
Yeah.
That's a tough one, let me think.
He is a game dude.
Cut it out.
Don't. He is the game dude, he is so rude.
That is pretty bad.
He is a gamer with a bad attitude.
Other creators have also made videos and streams about him since then, proving that while GameDude might be gone, he is not forgotten. But is he really gone? In 2019, there was a small sign of life. Something happened on GameDude's rarely used Twitter account. While he didn't make a tweet himself, there was activity of a recently liked tweet from Bernie Sanders. People took note of this and spread the news, causing a small number of people tweeting at GameDude trying to get in contact with him. Despite this, there's been no activity since. GameDude's videos have been archived on several channels. It begs the question if Alexander is the one behind any of these accounts. Well, I theorize he might be behind this one. Why do I say this? This channel first started posting back in early 2013, which coincides closely to when GameDude deleted his Alexander4488 channel. Secondly, and more importantly, this channel was posting the newest revisions of GameDude's reviews, and for a short while, even going so far as to delete and re-upload the videos, much like Alexander would do in the past. While GameDude is known for having many imposters, few if any went out of their way to delete and re-upload the videos like Alex would, and since this channel shows no activity of trolling behavior, this leads me to believe this was indeed his channel. Regardless, the channel has not been active in many years. Alexander was someone who had a problem with obsessing over things. You can see that in his videos, the way he would constantly revise them, and then later on when he couldn't let go of a relationship. Perhaps leaving the internet is the best thing he could have done for himself, both legally and mentally. I do hope that both Alexander and Alana have been able to move on from these incidents. Maybe YouTube is ripe for a GameDude comeback. Hell, look at how surprisingly well the Irate Gamers comeback in 2020 was received. Regardless, what he leaves behind is not only a bunch of memeable game reviews, but a bizarre unraveling of a person's YouTube career, personal life, and legal status.
Okay, it's recording. let me try that again. It's so funny.